Hello and welcome to Sheldopedia. It's Wednesday for Secular Tune. Nice to see ya. On today's show, we'll be discussing what's that response so far after I played Brutal by Olivia Rodrigo on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM.
I'll die before I drink. And I'm so caught up in the news of who likes me and who hates you. And I'm so tired that I might quit my job, start a new life. And they'd all be so disappointed, cause who am I if not exploited? And I'm so sick of 17. Where's my fucking teenage dream? If someone tells me one more time, enjoy your youth, I'm gonna cry. And I don't stick up for myself, I'm anxious and nothing can help. And I wish I'd done this before, and I wish people liked me more. All I did was try my best. Brutal out of here. I feel like no one wants me, and I hate the way I'm perceived. I only have two real friends, and lately I'm a nervous wreck, cause I love people I don't like, and I hate every song I write. And I'm not cool, and I'm not smart, and I can't even parallel park. All I did was try my best. Brutal out of here. Just have a really good time. Got a broken ego, broken heart.
That's Breathe by Olivia Rodrigo on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM. National leader Sheila Collins says she was told Here we go. National Party leader Sheldon Betteridge says she was told about a parliamentary service inquiry into Nick Smith months ago, and she did not advise for former Nelson MP to leave Parliament. Nationalist MP Smith suddenly announced his retirement from Parliament on Monday, citing our current parliamentary service inquiry to an employment issue. Among his reasons for retirement, his last official date as an MP will be June 10th. Next Thursday, parliamentary services have been conducting a confidential inquiry into feeble elder culture in my Wellington office. Last Friday, that has not concluded, Smith said. On Tuesday, National Deputy Leader Shane Reti said he was not aware to an incident prior to Smith's resignation on Monday. Collins did, however, say he was aware of an incident earlier. I think Nick probably told me around November, December, could have been January, but it was about Fed Hills Vice Me, Fed Hills, a parliamentary service inquiry, constable stuff in an interview. I also knew a little bit earlier that it's one of his staff members, Lee Fettis, during his campaign hour, someone occupied on that. But I also, these are parliamentary services employees, and it's obviously employment matters that we don't normally get involved in. I'm very glad no stage to tell Nick Smith to leave. Clause at Parliamentary Services has not briefed to on the investigation, but her understanding of the incident was pretty much what he's put out on public, that it was an inquiry into verbal altercation that he had with a staff member. A complaint to Parliamentary Services, not a staff member involved in the altercation, is believed to have a recording of an altercation. I mean, clearly not something that Parliamentary Services have been bothered or felt the need to brief me on. I haven't seen a draft report which Nick Cleary has from what he said to me, Collins said. Collins also said that Smith indicated to her last year that he did not intend to serve out the system as a national list MP, having lost a seat of Nelsa, which he had held since 1990 versus Tasman and Venice Nelson. Collins said she would be fully support Smith. He has been not seen in public since the announcement was made if he wanted to make a voluntary speech in Parliament. Collins was empathic that she did notify Smith to leave Parliament on the back of the allegations. A discussion that I have with my colleagues is fully confidential. I can tell you that no state have told any of my colleagues they need to go. G. Smith said that was the first news of Smith leaving was then when he called her on Monday while she was in Queensland for a brief meeting with Australian Prime Minister Scott Morrison to advise her of his plans. Collins said that the circumstances around the recording were suspicious. I understand that tape, which of course I haven't heard or seen any evidence of, was taped by someone who is not the staff member, it was someone else. So we'll make it a prime fact an illegal tape unless there's some particular defense that I can't think of, Collins said. I think it's very quickly it is that if there was for an instant MP who had physically assaulted a staff member or had physically assaulted another MP or physically assaulted, everybody then would be telling him it was time to go. Parliamentary Services Chief Executive Rafael Gonzalez Montero and Speaker Sheldon Mello fronted the Parliamentary Select Committee on Wednesday morning, and was asked by National MP Ian McKelvey about leaking of details of employment investigations. Gonzalez Montero said he had confidence in his staff and none of his personnel leaked details of investigation into Smith. I haven't found any evidence of any leaks coming from staff and around here or staff that are employed by the Parliamentary Services. I guess sometimes issues escalate, and if people don't see resolution to those issues, they might go to other things like media. As Melody, he did not get briefed on official employment cases and first learned of an investigation into Smith, and was then the press release went out on Monday. Oh, the thing was allegedly leaked by someone who was independent, and I understand on a report on an independent investigator was strife form but had not come back to anyone in the parliamentary service. Next song I will be playing is It is. Elsa by Emery and Niall Horan.
I'll be honest, I'm alright with me. Sunday mornings in my own bed sheets. I'll be waiting. Alone, I haven't thought of her for days. I'll be honest. can get you out my head. You never ever let me forget. Cause
just when I think you're gone, hear a song on the radio. Just like that takes me back to the places we used to go. Time I think that I can get you out my head. You never ever let me forget. Cause just when I think you're gone, hear a song on the radio. Just like that takes me back to the places we used to go. Hear a song on the radio.
Just like that takes me back to the places we used to go.
And I've been trying but I just can't fight it. When I hear it I just can't stop smiling. I remember you're gone, baby. It's just a song on the radio.
That was L Song by Emery and Noel Horan on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM. It's not a sort of place you typically find players who intrigue. Adele Reese's weak Zoom call above the presence of Reserve Bank Governor Adrian Orr before Palmer's Fires and Expenditure Committee last Wednesday touched on one of the most contentious aspects of our otherwise successful COVID-19 response. Or if there was a talk taking questions from MPs on the bank's latest statement about its monetary policy settings towards the end of a one-hour meeting, Green MP Chloe Sawbrook asked him about the recent paper the bank had produced, which pondered the effects of emergency interventions on the economy last year and had had on inequality. Sawbrook appeared on a press with a paper described as a review of international literature, which did not touch much on what it actually happened in this country. Do you think it's important to focus on the actual on-the-ground impact of monetary policy in Aotearoa New Zealand? She asked. Also, she asked, can you continue work on understanding the general effects of the bank's monetary stimulus, mainly digital money printing on inequality? Is this great area that we want to be world leading in understanding? Swarbrick's assessment of the paper was fair. It looks mainly to international studies of what effect recent monetary policy on the low cash rate as well as the digital money printing that has kept interest rates has had on inequity. Fiscal inclusion is intermediate, but the bank makes a case that it's more predictive to help reduce inequality by propping up consumer demand in the economy and keeping people in jobs. Of course, doing so alleged wave of mortgage lending and pumped up house prices. Inequality has almost certainly worsened thanks to the economic response to COVID-19. But the bank wants to remind you that COVID could be a whole lot loose, meaning more people could be unemployed. It's a perfectly fine story for the bank to tell. But compared itself to the worst case scenario isn't really the right answer to question. The bank and the government should be comparing what might happen under the best case scenario. Which would have kept unemployment low without pumping up a housing bubble. New Zealand has been very uncritical of the economic response of COVID-19, despite that story being far more complicated than a largely successful health response pending vaccine rollout. The economic response is really two stories, an employment story. It's one that everybody likes to tell because it paints a picture on the government that has managed the economic response every bit as well as health response, giving such and mamas and people fair jobs against all odds. The other story is least flattering. Skyrocketing house prices raising faster than most other comparable countries have stocked inequality. Calls down to social problems, so putting housing out of reach of many New Zealanders on ordinary or above ordinary incomes. Yes, but people still have jobs, but the money one earns isn't enough to provide basic shelter. Then, what's good it for? It's it for. The government has been thus far being uninterested in auditing economic response to COVID-19, which stands in stark contrast to the multiple audits carried on out in the health response. The Asia Federal report on contact tracing, a review into clusters in aged care facilities, a road report on issues at the border, and the ongoing audit for response to many few reports were occasionally, maybe often, damning, but they each improved for COVID response. Results of lack of interest had been predictable despite Reserve Bank and the Treasury warning before the pandemic even started. The monetary policy tools might have addressed consequences. The government wanted to wait a near year to do anything about them. Instead, both organizations effectively making their own homework, prediction reports monitoring the effects of government's interventions. Treasury and the bank also produced rosy forecasts showing the government's housing changes just taking effect this year. Of course, ministers don't have say in Treasury or Reserve Bank say about them, and there's no suggestion for agents of fidgeting moments to make government look good, but it's not ideal to have two powerful arms in government or to their own actions. When it's an obvious case for outside scrutiny. A reason why there's been no significant enthusiasm to a different economic response boils down to the old political maxim that ministers should never ask a question which may not like the answer. The government has been extraordinarily luxury to pick up whatever tools to manage their health response when it comes to economics. It faces far more political constraints. Constraints that will only get harder to overcome when it can no longer blame for COVID for needing to slay economic triple beefs. This is videos from Mark Taylor from Stuff. To say what about more on the Asia Federal?
We don't have a view on that yet. We are tasked with looking at the role that interest-only loans play, whether they are used too heavily at different times, leading to high price variability if they're being used for extreme risk taking. And so we will be coming back to the Minister around our ideas on that, as well as our debt to income stories. We asked for additional instruments, and we need to be able to explain what they can and can't do, and what some of the unintended consequences of a debt to income. Debt to income ratio, like a loan to value restriction, and even the official cash rate, they are blunt tools. And the challenge for a debt to income ratio, for example, is a higher, a more restrictive debt to income means it's harder to enter the housing market first and foremost, even though it may impact on house prices, lower house prices longer. So, you know, it has different impacts through time. And what the government wants to understand is what's the impact for first home buyers, owner occupiers, first and foremost, and what is the trade-off that they might have to think about if they gave us those DTIs.
Next song I will be playing for it is Bullet to the Brain by Megadeth. Jeez.
We'll be right back.
That was Bullet to the Brain by Megadeth on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM. The UK still have a system that allows power to be abused. Keir Starmer has said pressure weeks of stories about lobbying and cronyism and cash for Boris Johnson and flat renovation that the Labour Party will clean up our politics. And the fact that those before polls closed in the local mayoral Welsh and Scottish elections, Labour leader will attempt to draw close connections between the stories of 2016 and effect on ordinary people. Labour's sources say that Stumble would link the row over Johnson's ravaged refurbishments to the early days of a pandemic and question whenever the Prime Minister was distracted as he apparently sought the donors to sponsor the decorations which he now founded himself. The Electoral Commission last week launched an investigation into whenever any donations or loans to pay for the lavish refurbishment of his Downing Street flat were properly declared. Starmer will have a draw a clear decision between his charter and that of Johnson, describing his experience as lawyer prosecuting MPs for false expensive claims. Labour will also try to forge a link between cronyism and of a distribution of COVID contracts and taxpayers' cash, which advises believe a key to making a damaging allegation stick. Frustrating again, dismissed stories that he sought donors to pay for his personal life, including a nanny, as a trivia. That alleged would not be about bigger issues affecting people's lives. And as I believe this Dharma Rose and a good echo of how when I hear how a friend in the name of a toy minister gets fed a million of taxpayers' money, while towns and communities across the country see their local services cut. When I see the British people's money wasted on government contracts and I don't deliver. If I were a Prime Minister, I would stop the abuse of taxpayers' money, to stop the wasteful approach, outsourcing contracts and clean up our politics. When I was a director of public prosecution, I was not afraid to prosecute MPs who have broken their rules over MPs' expensive as Prime Minister, I will not be afraid to overhaul the system as just allow power to be abused. He said the choice will be between Labour Party that focuses on the country or consider government providing factors. Those who have ministers on their WhatsApp kind of contacts. The Prime Minister came through the pressure of a weekend over donations right after the Scottish Tory leader Douglas Lord said Johnson should be, of course, quit if he has found to have breached the code. Speaking of reporters on Monday, Starmer said it was significant Johnson's own party agreed it was unacceptable. It was good to see senior conservatives recognize the seriousness of a situation that for privacy could be in and implication of breaching ministerial codes, he said during a visit to Lewisham, South East London. over the last week or so, some people said holding the government, holding the Prime Minister to account is somewhat party politics is still showing that isn't messaged cross party need to uphold status in the public office, and I think other senior minister conservatives should follow suit now. On Monday, Johnson was campaigning in Hartlepool, where Tories are challenging Labour in a crucial by election, asked about refurbishments to his Downing Street flat. all this kind of stuff is actually not relevant to this campaign, and what a thing people of this country want to know is who is supposedly and who is actually taking the issues that matter to the people of this country. I know people want to focus on trivia, but I'm focusing on the issues that matter. Reason polls that small shift towards Labour as a scandal has dominated front pages. Devin Rogers was put Labour within 5 points of the Conservatives. Well, Revere wins World Bowl on Monday, showing 2-point gap, having shown a 10-point gap last week. Starmer said he will take full responsibility whenever outcome before the elections on Thursday. I will take responsibility for everything that Labour Party does, he told reporters. This is from last month. The Conservatives have won 100%. Next week, Damien O'Connor will head to London and Brussels to make heroes potential local trip talks between UK and EU, but he may not receive an entirely warm welcome. New Zealand politicians and agriculture figures downplayed British farmers. Baseball key exports flooding the market as the domestic politics threatened to host a swift conclusion to free trade talks. In mid-June, Trade and Export Growth Minister Damien O'Connor will head to London and Brussels for discussion about New Zealand's free trade negotiations with the United Kingdom and European Union. O'Connor will be the first government minister to travel offshore since the COVID-19 pandemic began, during a 2-week stay in a managed isolation upon his return. Some peace and quiet recorded exactly what he needs after his trip, depending on the reception he receives from British farmers. While O'Connor has his British counterpart Liz Truss recently announced plans to accelerate negotiations, there's been some unrest within the UK over reported zero tariff offer for both countries. Feeding programs that British farmers may protest at the G20 summit scheduled to take place in Cornwall next month, while an opinion piece for the Mail on Sunday, National Farmers Union President Minnie Batters claimed the removal of tariffs would make life unbearable for small British family farms. The plaintiff is removing tariffs for fast and international farms of Australian beef or New Zealand lamb, or God forbid allowing zero tariffs on all produce could spell the end. But speaking to Newsom ahead of his trip, O'Connor said those fears were misplaced. The total farms we put on its markets are both massive. Both Australia and New Zealand want to complement the import for most beef producers, and we don't want to in any way undermine a value and marketplace of your product, ours. I think I stressed to the New Zealand UK deal could be finalized during this visit, but he was hopeful progress could be made. Some of the most sensitive issues with the timeline set for completion, given a significant symbolic value for the UK being able to show it was open for business pro post Brexit. We hope our ordinary faith to recognise fear has to be compromised, but we are holding to our for a commercially meaningful trade agreement. Otherwise, what's the point? National Party Trade Spokesman Tom Wall told Newton the government needed to ensure that secure the same level of unequivocal free market access for goods and services from the UK as was being offered to Australia, with transition period if necessary. Muller said O'Connor needed to repeal any attempt to impose unnecessary regulations on agricultural producers to undercut the cost of competitiveness of exports. The environmental chamber probably called that fire court allowed the concerns of British farmers about allegedly inferior products flooding the market by showing that New Zealand produces most environmentally efficient animal products in the world. When it comes to trade talks with the EU, the government appeared to be treated water air after 10 rounds of negotiations and needed to get a better understanding of why they are setting realised to engage in any meaningful way in New Zealand. Muller also skeptical about the EU's demands around geographical indications in which he sees causing concern within the agriculture sector. The idea of fetishes can't be called fetishes because we make it superbly down here. It just seems nonsense. Just be nonsense for a town's growth of kiwi fruit not be able to call it a kiwi fruit. What counts the quality of a product, the branding of your relationship with consumer, not trying to come out with accurate defense and anti-competitive mechanism to stop trade. It's the guy media for Meat Industry Association Senior Manager for Strategy, Trade Policy and Agri-C. Told newspaper organizations appreciated O'Connor's willingness to travel given COVID restrictions and also for calling cash up a more meaningful offer from both UK and EU. Gay Meekin see for understood British farmers appreciation that trade liberalisation would mean for them in the post-Brexit world, but New Zealand had shown itself to be a responsible actor that would not flood the market with substandard produce. But farmers don't receive subsidies, LCDs as much exposed to market dynamics and where global traders will export 210 different markets around the world, and as a consequence, we sell a product to where our customers are willing to pay the highest price for it. The lack of movement from the EU is this market access was on a concern and undermined by credibility and a supposed world leader on trade policy, she said. Dave Harris and Beef Labs, New Zealand General Manager for Policy and Agriculture, said he was not surprised with the reaction of a British farmers for a potential terms of Australia and New Zealand deals, as it was unlikely that even border zero tariff offer would be on the table. However, UK media have been tended to lump together for two countries when talking about the farming conditions, even if it reveals significant variations in practice. They talk about these massive cattle stations in North Queensland and the scale which they operate for use of growth hormone products, which has no real relevance in New Zealand to the New Zealand context, but they don't get fat. The fact is, New Zealand was not following its using its current quota limits for sheep exports to the UK, so having access to a market to not many countries would exploit it, Harrison said. Next song will be Armin van Buuren's. This is what it feels like from 2013.
Telephone. without you now. This is what it feels like.
That was Fair What It Feels Like by Armin Van Buuren on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM. Since Dan O'Connor's going to England this week for a potential meeting with Liz Truss over the Brexit trade deal on agriculture, Ontario Felicity might outrage British farmers, but I'm going to tell you the top 10 countries by agriculture production. Gonna tell you the top 10 agriculture countries in the world. There's a top 10 list. I'm struggling to find the top 10 list, but I have to go to the next song, which is It's a East by Epa.
Save.
That was SOS by Eba on Sheldopedia on LRE FM. Guys, I take the top 10 most agricultural countries in the world. Total production 145 million MT. Number 9, new biggest on total production in 2019, 105 million MT. Number 8, Iran total production in 2019, 202 million MT. Number 7, Russia total production in 2019, 260 million MT. Number 6, Chile total production in 2019, 225 million MT. Number 5, Brazil total production in 2019, 268 million MT. Total production in 2019, 574 million MT. Number 3, Turkey total production in 2019, 5.83 million MT. Number 2, the United States total production in 2019, 789 million MT. And number 1 country goes to China with total production 53.24 million MT. Next song I will be playing, it is Brutal. It will be I'm getting it by Def Leppard.
Better come inside when you're better. But no chance if you don't wanna
That was Armageddon It by Def Leppard on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM. The fact of the day is McDonald's once made bubblegum flavour broccoli. Physicists intrusive fat will with taste buds crawling. Unsurprised they attempt to get kids to eat healthier did not go over well with the child testers who were confused by the taste. Right, that's it for Sheldopedia. I hope you have a good time. And I'll see you next Friday. Bye-bye.